Welcome friends, Igor is here, and in this video we will derive several elementary consequences of the 10 vector space properties. In this lesson, we will discover several interesting properties of vector spaces which follow from the original 10 properties of vector spaces, and because there are consequences of the vector space axioms, they are not part of the initial list of the requirements. Also, we will illustrate these interesting properties using the crazy vector space as an instance of a vector space structure. Let's get started. Each vector space must have a zero vector. Let's prove that this zero vector is in fact unique. There is a simple pattern how to prove that an object with certain properties is unique. We are going to assume there are two such objects, and we are going to prove that they're equal to each other. So, let's assume we have two vectors in the vector space V. Both of these vectors satisfy the properties of the zero vector. Then, we're going to look at the first zero vector plus the second zero vector. Let's use our assumption that the second zero vector is the zero vector. This means that this sum is equal to the first zero vector. On the other hand, we also know that vector addition is commutative, therefore we can switch the order of the summation of the two vectors. And now, let's use our assumption that 0, 1 is the zero vector. So therefore, the vector 0, 2 plus the vector 0, 1 is the vector 0, 2. Now, if you look at the beginning and the end, it tells you that the vector 0, 1 is the same as the vector 0, 2. And this proves that in a vector space, there is only one zero vector. Next, we know that each vector in the vector space has an additive inverse. Let's prove that this additive inverse is unique. Well, you know the drill by now. We're going to take a vector u, and we're going to assume that it has two additive inverses. Our goal is to prove that these two additive inverses are equal to each other. To do this, let's look at the following expression. We assumed that negative u2 is an additive inverse of the vector u, therefore they add up to the zero vector. And now, the vector negative u1 plus the zero vector is the vector negative u1. But on the other hand, the original expression with which we started can also be written in this way. This is the associative property of vector addition. Now, let's recall our assumption that the vector negative u1 is an additive inverse of a vector u. Therefore, they add up to the zero vector. Now, zero vector plus another vector is that other vector. If you look at the beginning and the end of this computation, you see that it tells you that the two additive inverses are equal to each other, and therefore, each vector in the vector space has only one additive inverse. Now, you know from explicit objects such as column vectors that if you take a column vector and you scale the column vector by zero scalar, what you'll get is the zero column vector. Let's prove that this also holds in general for all vector spaces. Here is a trick. I'm going to start with the vector 0u and I'm going to consider this vector added to the zero vector. Of course, zero vector does not change the expression. But now I am going to replace the zero vector with a vector plus its negative, and the vector in this case is the vector 0u. Next, I am going to apply the associative property for vector addition. Next, I am going to use the property that alpha u plus beta u is alpha plus beta scalar multiple u. In this case, alpha is equal to 0 and beta is equal to 0. But 0 plus 0, we're talking about numbers now, is 0. So what we have now is a vector plus its negative. This is the zero vector. And now you see that this tricky computation shows that indeed scaling any vector by zero scalar results in a zero vector in any vector space. Would anyone dare to say now that mathematics is boring? Look at the creativity in this proof. Now, let's switch the roles. The vector is going to be the zero vector, and the scalar is going to be arbitrary scalar. we are going to prove that a scalar multiple of the zero vector is always the zero vector, regardless of what the scalar is. We are going to come up with yet another ingenious way to prove it. Standard trick, which you learned in the previous slide. We are going to replace the vector with the same vector plus the zero vector. The zero vector I'm going to replace with a vector plus its negative. Then I'm going to use the associative property of vector addition. And then I'm going to use the property that alpha u plus alpha v is alpha times u plus v. In this case, vector u is the zero vector and vector v is the zero vector. But zero vector plus zero vector is the zero vector. This is the property of the zero vector. When you add zero vector to anything else, you do not change the result. So think of this as follows. In the sum zero vector plus zero vector, the second zero vector simply disappears. But now what we have is a vector plus its negative. And of course the result is the zero vector. So look at the beginning and the end. We have proved that a scalar multiple of a zero vector by any scalar is just a zero vector. Next, we are going to prove a very important property that will help us work and write linear combinations in arbitrary vector spaces. Here is this property. To get the additive inverse of any vector, all you need to do is to scale this vector by number negative 1. Now, this first step may seem super ingenious to someone, but not to us. We've seen it plenty of times by now. In this video, we proved that if you take any vector and scale by the zero scalar, you're going to get the zero vector. So this is what I'm using in this computation now. The zero scalar I'm going to replace with 1 plus negative 1. Then I'm going to use the distributive property. Alpha plus beta scalar multiple u is alpha u plus beta u. In this case, alpha is 1, beta is negative 1. And now comes the crucial part of this proof. Remember this property number 10 of a vector space, which said a seemingly obvious thing that a scalar multiple of any vector by scalar 1 is equal to the original vector. Well, now, this proof is why we need this assumption. Because a scalar multiple of the vector u by the scalar 1 is the same as simply vector u. This argument would not work without that assumption. So the true reason we have that property number 10 is to have this property that the additive inverse of any vector is a scalar multiple of the vector by negative 1. This would not be true unless we assume that the scalar multiple of a vector by 1 is the vector itself. Well, I got carried away a little, so let's get back on track to our proof. Our next step is to use the associative property of vector addition, and of course a vector plus its negative is the zero vector. Zero vector disappears, and what you have is the additive inverse of any vector is a scalar multiple of that vector by negative 1. From now on, we will sometimes use minus signs in linear combinations of vectors, even though we do not have an operation of vector subtraction. But you should recognize that when we say minus a vector, what we really mean is plus the additive inverse of that vector. Finally, let's prove that if a scalar multiple of a vector is the zero vector, then the scalar must be the zero number or the vector must be the zero vector. This is going to be proved by cases. Case 1, let's assume that the scalar alpha is the zero scalar. Then our statement alpha is zero or u is the zero vector is true in this case, and so we're done. The second complementary case is when the scalar alpha is not equal to zero. I will prove that in this case the vector u must be the zero vector. Now, again, we are going to use the property that the vector is equal to its scalar multiple by the scalar 1. See how important this property is? Because I assumed that alpha is a non-zero number, there is an object 1 over alpha. This is the multiplicative inverse of the number alpha. And so I replace 1 with 1 over alpha multiplied by alpha. Next, I'm using an associative property for scalar multiplication. And our assumption is that a scalar multiple of u by alpha is the zero vector. But this scalar multiple is the zero vector. Why? Because we already proved in this video that a scalar multiple of the zero vector is always the zero vector, no matter what the scalar is. So, what it means is that if alpha is a non-zero scalar, then the vector u must be the zero vector. But in this case, the statement alpha is equal to zero, or u is the zero vector, is also true, because u is the zero vector. So, in either case, our statement is true, and therefore, we have proved the theorem. Remember the crazy vector space from the last video? I think it would be instructive to illustrate these properties using the crazy vector space. Let's take an arbitrary vector u in this vector space, and objects in this space are ordered pairs of numbers. First, I will illustrate the property that any vector scaled by the zero scalar is the zero vector. Notice how nicely it works out, even though in the crazy vector space the zero vector is the pair negative 1, negative 1. Next, let me illustrate the property that the zero vector scaled by any scalar alpha is just the zero vector. Again, just by some kind of a miracle, this property does hold. Or is there any miracle really when we proved that this property must hold for every vector space? We do not discriminate vector spaces, no matter how crazy they are. Finally, this is an illustration that the additive inverse of a vector is a scalar multiple of the vector by negative 1. If you found this video useful, please give it a like to help others discover this content and subscribe to this channel to see more of these videos. In the next video in this series, we will consider subspaces of vector spaces. I will see you later.